Hello, my name is Henry Abramson. I'm a historian at Turo College, and I would like to take a few short videos just to explain to you what exactly the history of the Talmud is. We're going to begin with its origins today, and then we're going to extend all the way up to the 21st century because it is one of those documents that actually has such a phenomenal impact on the Jewish intellectual and spiritual tradition. It is intrinsically tied up with the Jewish communities around the world and across the centuries, and understanding some basics about the Talmud is essential to really understanding anything about Judaism or the Jewish people. Now, let us first begin with a very simple question. What is the Talmud? So it's a complicated and long answer, but here's the short answer. The first thing I like to say is, the Talmud, also known as the Gemara, those terms are synonymous, is a massive ancient commentary on a document called the Mishnah. And when I say massive, I'm talking about over 5,000 pages, although they're typically numbered in folios, that is both sides of one page, and there are 2,711 of those folios. Now, you might wonder, what exactly is the Mishnah? We'll talk more about it in the next lecture, but for now, let's go on with what exactly the Talmud or Gemara is. It was compiled in late antiquity, which means somewhere between the 3rd and the 5th centuries. Scholars disagree about exactly when the beginning and when the ending of the process occurred. And it was based on much older oral traditions. We're talking about centuries and centuries older oral traditions that found their way into a document which was edited by a series of rabbis. And this editing process occurred in two basic places. One is in the land of Israel, particularly in the north, and secondly, in the land of Babylonia, the Mesopotamian region between the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers. As we'll discuss later, that's why there are actually two different texts called the Talmud. There is the so-called Jerusalem Talmud, which is the one that was composed in the land of Israel earlier, and then a later one, which was composed in the land of Babylonia, called, of course, the Babylonian Talmud. Third thing I'd like to say about what it is, like, what does it talk about? Besides being a commentary on the Mishnah, we don't know what that is yet, but it runs the gamut of Jewish thought. It concentrates on law, that's probably most of its discussion, but it treats virtually every aspect of the human condition. It talks about metaphysics, it goes to medicine. It talks about philosophy, it goes to friendship. It has recipes, it has, you know, observations about the behavior of animals and the heavenly spheres and all kinds of amazing things. It is a rather phenomenally amazing, interesting document that is quite unlike anything that I am aware of, certainly in the Western tradition, as God willing, we'll see a little bit over the course of these lectures. The language of the Talmud is principally Aramaic, which was the lingua franca of the Jews when it was compiled, but the Mishnah is written in a form of Hebrew, and there's considerable infusion of words and syntax and expressions from other languages, including, you know, Greek and Akkadian and Persian and all kinds of things are all kind of like folded into the Talmud. It is central to the curriculum of a rabbinical seminary, yeshiva, even today, and parts of the Talmud are avidly studied by Jews all over the world. So that's a quick definition of what the Talmud is. Let us now approach our main subject, which is the history of the Talmud. When was it started? So this is essentially a theological question because it remained an oral document for so many centuries. And in fact, it's called Torah Shebaal Peh, the Torah that is, you know, discussed orally, as opposed to the Torah that is written down, which is the five books of Moses. Speaking of Moses, here is Moses, or at least this is Charlton Heston portraying Moses. I happen to really like using these kinds of images because a lot of people tell me I have a striking resemblance to Moses, as you know. Let's take it from the perspective of Jewish theology. In terms of the history of the Talmud, it's written very clearly in the first chapter, the first Mishnah of a tractate called Pirkei Avot that says, Moses received the Torah at Sinai and transmitted it to Joshua. And by the way, when it says Torah here, it's referring to the totality of Torah, both the written Torah and the oral Torah, which contains the essential elements of the Talmud as we have it today. Joshua, his disciple and his successor, then transmitted it to the elders. The elders transmitted it to the prophets, and the prophets to an organization called the Men of the Great Assembly. And then there's a little statement here about what the men of the Great Assembly would say. They used these beautiful things. We'll just finish the Mishnah. They said three things. Be deliberate in justice, meaning do not rush to judgment. Raise many disciples and make a fence around the Torah, which means create like kind of a protective barrier around accidental transgression of the Torah. So according to Jewish theology, the entire Talmud goes all the way back to Mount Sinai, that it was transmitted orally, as it were, you know, from a teacher to a student, from a teacher to a student, for many, many, many generations, until, because of political reasons, which we'll discuss in a subsequent lecture, it had to be committed to writing. So the version that we use today is the version committed to writing, but it is intimately connected with the oral communication between teacher and student. The essence of the Talmud is essentially debate. You know, we have an expression, two Jews, three opinions. And so this is not a document which is kind of like a list of rules. It is a give and take. It is a discussion. It is a stream of consciousness conversation, a transcript of a massive debate that encompasses hundreds, actually thousands of rabbis, taking place over many centuries in many different civilizations. So let's go first to the biblical period. So the biblical period, which refers to what's going on in what the Jews call Tanakh. They do not call it the Old Testament because, of course, Jews do not recognize a New Testament. The Old Testament is working just fine, thank you, and there's no reason to upgrade it to a new version of the software. Tanakh is the Hebrew term which refers to the three sections as Jews recognize the Bible, the Torah, which is the first five books, the Nevi'im, the prophets, and the Ketuvim, which are the writings, which include things like Psalms and Proverbs and things like that. And the history that's described there goes all the way from the patriarchs and matriarchs of Genesis through the Exodus from Egypt, enslavement and then Exodus, the giving of the Torah, which changes a lot of things for how Jews relate to God and relate to the world around them, and then through the first and second commonwealths when the Jews had sovereignty in the land of Israel, you know, with great figures like King David, King Solomon, and so on in the first commonwealth, and then in the second commonwealth, after a short but painful exile to Babylonia, they came back in the late 6th century before the Common Era and rebuilt the temple again. So, wow, I just went through hundreds of years in like three sentences. The second period, which is really important because now we begin to see a lot of the texts of the Talmud being very closely associated with the cultures in which Jews lived, has to do with the conquest of Alexander the Great. If you have a look at this map, you'll see that Alexander marched out of northern Greece, Macedonia. He is known as Alexander Mokdon, Alexander the Macedonian in Talmudic texts. And he conquers an amazing amount of territory in a very short period of time before he dies at a young age. He does not destroy Jerusalem, for which Jews are eternally grateful, so much so that they even name their children after him. My own grandfather, Alav HaShalom, was named Alexander, and I named one of my sons Alexander as well. Not for Alexander the Great, but for Alexander, my great-grandfather. My grandfather, who was great, who was my grandfather, not my great-grandfather, but he was great. During this time, the Jews are exposed to Hellenism. Hellenism is essentially the Greek way of looking at the world, which encompasses Greek science, Greek rhetoric, Greek drama, Greek art, Greek literature, Greek aesthetics, Greek math. I mean, it just goes on and on. The Greeks had such a fascinating and different way of looking at the world than the Jews did, that they were overwhelmed by this. And in fact, one of the great problems that the Jews had to deal with at this time was try to figure out, okay, how do we use this fascinating body of information that the Greeks have given to this region without diluting our Jewish traditions? It was such a difficult tradition, difficult, crevasse to cross that they ended up having a national revolt over it, really a civil war, which resulted in the Hanukkah rebellion of the Maccabees and drove out the more aggressively Hellenizing Jewish movements and concentrating on making Israel much more traditionalist. This lasted for several centuries. Here's actually one of my favorite pictures from our depicting the period. This is actually a 14th century European Christian rendition of one of the dramatic moments in the Maccabean War. I'm not sure why I'm showing it to you, but I kind of like it, so I guess I will. There's a famous scene in which Elazar the Maccabee was heroically attacked a war elephant. The Syrian Greeks, who were the allies of the Hellenizing Jews in Israel, actually brought in these tremendous beasts to fight against the rebels unsuccessfully. Elazar heroically dove underneath the elephant, stabbed it from below, and killed it, although he was tragically crushed in the maneuver. This is a description we have in the Book of Maccabees. What I really like about this picture is that obviously the European Christian artist here had no idea what an elephant looked like, and he was basing it on a few different descriptions. He says, well, it looks sort of like a gray horse with a very long nose. So anyways, let's just go on. I don't know why I said that, but I kind of liked it, so let's go on. From that Greek encounter, we have to go into the Roman and Babylonian periods, because what ends up happening is the Jews reestablish their sovereignty under the Maccabees and their dynasty, known as the Hasmonean or the Hashmonaim, after the year 165 before the Common Era. And that goes pretty well, although it slowly enters into a period of decay where Hellenizing influences increase. Ultimately, in the year 63, before the Common Era, Pompey enters with Roman forces and takes over the region and incorporates Israel within the larger Roman Empire. Here's a map that shows you what the Roman Empire looked like in the year 117. And here's a tiny little piece of Judea, which is a section of the Roman Empire at this point. The Jews survive under Roman rule with some significant elements of friction. They actually have two, according to some historians, three wars. The first one fought from 66 to 74, in which the temple was tragically destroyed. A second minor revolt, somewhere around the time that this map depicts, and then the horrific Bar Kokhba revolt in the year 132 that resulted in such tremendous persecution of the Jews and a dispersion of the Jews throughout the region. So in this period, they're encountering not only Hellenism, but Roman culture, which has other unique features as well. Finally, we should look over here at Sassanid Persia, the region in which the Jews had lived, and actually going all the way back to the very first exile in the year 586, there were Jews who were settling in Babylonia, and in particular in this region here, if we zoom in, you can see the two blue lines that extend from the upper left down into the Gulf there. Those are the rivers Tigris and the Euphrates, and in that region called Mesopotamia, because it is between the rivers, Meso means between and Potamos means river, there are a lot of Jewish settlements. They ended up growing and becoming very significant, and ultimately, especially after the decline of the land of Israel under the Romans, they become the centers of Talmudic learning. And so basically, the Talmud is developing in both Israel and in Babylon, and as I mentioned earlier, that's where ultimately we have two distinct texts recorded. Okay, so that was kind of a quick, maybe verbose overview of where the Talmud was formed and the historical context in which the Talmud was formed. I want to take 1 minute to talk about what the Talmud is certainly not. Now, because a lot of people are going to see this video, not necessarily people who are committed to the study of the Talmud for its own sake, I've shut off all comments, because there are a lot of people who have this crazy idea that the Talmud is some kind of like secret document that is the whole rules for the secret world Jewish conspiracy, which does not exist, by the way, and that somehow it's this nefarious document. A lot of this anti-Semitic thought springs from the twisted mind of an individual named Johann Andreas Eisenmenger, who in the late 1600s portrayed himself as a potential convert to Judaism in order to study the Talmud primarily. And he spent 19 years doing this. And he was actually quite a brilliant scholar. He went through the entire Talmud. He went through all kinds of midrashim, things like that. And then in the year 1700, he came up with this nasty 2,000-page book, which took every single passage he could possibly twist and take out of context and present it as a horrible condemnation of Judaism and Jews and so on. Now, this is not—he was not the first person to do this. A rather bizarre, obsessive kind of individual. We have people doing this for a few centuries prior, but you know, in reality, that's not what the Talmud is all about. If you don't believe me, there are lots of places where you can see Talmud the way Jews see the Talmud. I do not recommend you go to anti-Semitic websites because they will essentially just repeat Eisenmenger over and over again. You know, go see how Jews deal with the Talmud, and you will be assured that it's basically just this. Well, it's not basically anything. It is a fascinating discussion of how Jews encounter the universe and try to get closer to God in the process. Okay, that's it for this quick video. The next video will be looking at the Mishnah, which is the core document of the Talmud. We'll try to understand how and why that was formed in the historical context of its compilation, and then we'll get a better understanding as to what exactly the Talmud is and how it was composed in its historical context. Thank you very much for watching.